Thanks very much for having me here today to talk about something that I don't really care about as much as the stuff I've been listening about. I obviously care about native fish a great deal, and that's the reason why I'm pretty excited about the idea to take action to control carp, and why I'm really happy to be having a chat with you today. Look, I think it's really useful when I'm talking about carp to start with a mud map. The mud map of the journey I want to take you through today is as follows. I want to summarise some of the science underpinning the National Carp Control Plan. I want to explain what the National Carp Control Plan is and what it's not. I want to outline proposed research under the National Carp Control Plan. I want to explore some novel case studies to help us to really understand opportunities for pest control we can learn from with carp control in Australia. And maybe overarching all of that, I just want to answer your questions. And lastly, ask for your help. But first, I want to, just for context, consider, why would we do this? Let's not kid ourselves. We are talking about releasing a biological control agent to control a pest that infests around 1 million square kilometres. We're talking about extracting about 500,000 tonnes, maybe more than that, from Australian waterways. To put that in context, that eclipses our national seafood production. Why would we do this? The answer, as we saw early on from some great work led by Ian Ellis's and others, is because the benefits are likely to be significant. We have so many great case studies showing that when you do control carp, through whatever means, you can see really nice outcomes in terms of changes to water quality, changes to habitat. This is some research down in Mildura. You might not be able to see this, but this is an exclusion fence. So carp can't get in here, they can get in here. You can see a dramatic change in the aquatic vegetation. And of course, we know that healthy habitats lead to healthy ecosystems and healthy fisheries. Ultimately, that's the thing we care about, many of us in this room, right? So there's some fantastic historical work by Jody Frawley and Will Truman, looking back to the early 1900s, speaking to older farmers and fishers and validating their recollections through looking at their images, showing that in places like Echuca in the 1920s, you could catch 18 to 22 kilos of native fish per angler hour. That was the average. So let me just pause on that for a moment. If you finished work at 5 o'clock in the afternoon in the 1920s, and you had an hour before you had to start supper, you could grab your fishing rod, go down to the river around Echuca with a reasonable expectation of taking home 18 to 22 kilos of native fish. Hands up, those of us in the room who fish, the last time you had a 1 hour fishing trip where you took home 18 to 22 kilos of native fish, or even released that much. Anyone? You would be lucky to do that in a week now. So the point I'm trying to make is we have lost so much and we've forgotten what we've lost. And if we want our rivers to restore to the level of health that they used to be, or our fisheries to approach anything close to what they used to be, we have to do a few innovative things, including take action to control carp. So I want to make a point that we do have a problem in Australia with carp right now. This is some video footage from Nida Wetland in South Australia, but even more recent history, right throughout the Lower Murray-Darling Basin in March, April, May this year, we were travelling through and talking to people on the ground about their experiences in recent memory, because there was a big flood across Christmas, as I'm sure we would all remember. Flooded floodplain in warmer months is fantastic for carp spawning, and we saw spawning on huge levels. These sort of images are really quite common in the lower basin in the last few months. We spoke to irrigators who complained that they couldn't turn their pumps on because they would quickly clog with juvenile carp. We spoke to recreational fishers who were no longer throwing their yabby traps in the water because in half an hour they were catching 200 carp and no yabbies. So this is a problem right now. That particular spawning event just after that, a couple of months ago in South Australia, resulted in media coverage like this, which was a single fishing competition where 500 recreational fishers caught 16,000 carp in 8 hours. This little girl with a bit of fishing line tied to a stick caught 60 by herself. The point I'm trying to make is that, yeah, this is a problem, and this is not going to go away by itself. We have to look at doing something decisive. So what can we do? What have we done? It's fair to say since the early 60s, when carp really exploded, There have been all manner of things that have been tried. As a nation, we have thrown everything at this species. We've tried commercial fishing, recreational fishing carp buster events. We've tried manipulating water levels in wetlands to strand carp in the wetlands. We've put screens on the inlets of wetlands so that the carp couldn't get in there. We've tried putting radio transmitters into carp so that they can lead us back to the school. We've tried trapping. We've tried increasing the effectiveness of traps by synthesizing sex pheromones. We've tried modifying the genes of fish so that they have only one sex offspring. And all of those things have been wholeheartedly ineffective in delivering landscape scale reduction in carp numbers. Quite simply, what we've been doing hasn't been working, and we need to do something different. What we are doing throughout Australia is investing a lot of money and effort in recovering our waterways through environmental water. I need to make a really important point here, and that's that we are doing that because it works. There's empirical evidence showing that nesting water birds respond really positively, that vegetation communities respond really well, red gums love it as we know, and that some native fish species respond really well too. Here's another thing that responds really well to any water on the floodplain, not just man-made, but natural carp. So this is some fish sampling from a single man-made flood a couple of years ago in the lower Murray-Darling Basin. You might not be able to see that, but every one of those fish is carp. You might ask, is that a lot of carp? Yeah, that was. That was around 1 million carp per hectare. You might say, is that a big figure? Yeah, that is. If every one of those carp was 10 grams, that would result in 10,000 kilos per hectare. Now, the scientific literature says a really dense infestation of carp in a natural system is around 3,000 kilos per hectare. So that's off the charts. So I want to make one final point, which is we need to continue to deliver environmental water because it works. But as we do that, we need to recognise that there are winners and losers, and carp are winners. So we need to do things to control this carp problem as we continue to track and encourage recovery of our waterways. So that's why we are in a situation where we are looking at using biocontrol, this critter here, a virus, to control carp in Australia. A couple of things about this virus. First of all, it wasn't cooked up in a lab. This is a virus that first turned up in Israel, United Kingdom, and Germany in the late 90s and started to decimate carp populations there. Quickly started to spread around the world, is now found in actually 33 countries around the world. It was spread as people were moving carp around, not knowing that they were moving this virus around. And so it was decimating carp numbers globally, you know. And our researchers from the CSIRO started to think, maybe we could use this as a tool. And over about 8 years, they started to do research to understand, could this be a useful biocontrol agent for carp? So a couple of, high points from that research. First of all, we've found through the research by CSIRO that it meets the critical criteria for a biological control agent for carp. First of all, it's species specific. I'll talk about that a little more later on. But secondly, it is highly effective in killing carp. So like I said, this is a virus found in over 33 countries around the world. In the scientific literature, they've examined this virus in a lot of infinitely complex ecosystems just like ours and reported mortality rates of carp, the same species we have in Australia, from this virus, the same species we're looking to use, mortality rates of 70% and higher, sometimes approaching 100%. So in natural ecosystems internationally, yeah, this thing kills a lot of carp. But I know what you're saying, that's not an Australian carp, right? Well, research from CSIRO tested Australian carp and found within 6 days, 100% of those carp died after injection with this virus. Now I know what you're saying, that's not the way carp would be infected in natural ecosystems, and you're right. So 96% or higher is the mortality rate of carp that were exposed to contaminated water through bathing. So basically just putting the virus in some water, bathing the carp in it, and then observing them. Within 9 days, 96% or higher have died. So what I'm trying to say is internationally, and when looking at Australian context, Australian carp, this is a virus that can cause very high mortality levels when used under appropriate circumstances. So I want to bust a myth here, or at least reaffirm a really important point, which is this is not a foregone conclusion. All of the evidence we have today shows that this is the most efficient and possibly most effective tool for the control of carp in Australia, but we have more work to do. There'll be a decision made at the end of next year on how we go forward with carp control in Australia. And between now and then, we're going to be pretty busy doing a lot of stuff, including securing relevant legislative approvals, completion of a really ambitious research program, Completion of a systematic and quantitative risk assessment process, a really robust benefit cost analysis to make sure the benefits outweigh the risks, the costs, I'm sorry. Developing a strategy for the release and the cleanup of this virus, of the fish that succumbed to the virus. Benchmark ecosystem monitoring so we have a basis for comparison, so we know if we've been successful if we go forward. Education and consultation, and planning and coordination. So this cuts across every state and territory with the exception of the Northern Territory, all levels of government. So many levels of community in terms of their groups and their, you know, there are so many players in this space, and so coordination will be critical. Now, if we get the approval at the end of next year, there's a whole range of activities that follow, but I really just want to make the point that we are here right now. We're in this planning space. We're in the space of doing research and in consultation. We don't have the resources or the, you know, we don't have the funds to release the virus. We don't have the funds to do the cleanup yet. But we have $15 million from the Australian government to do a really good job of exploring this opportunity in detail. I want to make a point that carp biocontrol is already the most well-researched vertebrate biocontrol case study in the world. And we're about to put another $5 million into this to really make sure that we understand if we go forward how, and if we don't, why we shouldn't. We've developed a strategic research and technology plan in consultation with all the states and territories. This is our blueprint for all of the questions that we are going to answer over the next 18 months to inform that decision at the end of next year. This is not going to be on a quiz, but these are a subsample, if you like, of some of the research questions that we're going to be answering over the next 18 months. Why I'm showing you this is, number one, to show you that there's a lot of research that's going on. Number two, to tell you that it really answers two broad questions. First of all, is it viable to use this virus as a biocontrol agent? And if so, how? And we're doing a lot of different projects, as I mentioned. I'm not going to go into these one by one, but I'm really happy to answer a few more, in questions, go into a bit more detail if people are interested. But look, I think it's useful at this case, at this point, for us to really discuss case studies that we can learn from in terms of successful pest control. How might this work? What can we learn from things that have happened elsewhere? And so just a bit of a show of hands, if I can go before I go any further. Who here is familiar with the documentary series Game of Thrones? Yeah, okay, cool. So I'm going to assert here that Game of Thrones, we can learn a lot from Game of Thrones in terms of successful pest invasions. And I'm going to draw some comparisons here as to why biocontrol of carp is really useful. So look, to anyone who is not familiar, and to recap on anyone that is familiar, the area of Westeros is infected by these things called Whitewalkers. These Whitewalkers are pretty nasty critters, pretty hard to kill. And as I was reflecting on this case study, it occurred to me that there are some striking similarities between the Whitewalker infestation and the carp infestation, which I'll go through here. First of all, both carp and Whitewalkers come from the far north. In the case of carp, they occur from Europe and Asia in the northwest, and Whitewalkers in the north of Westeros. Second, building a wall will not help in containing this problem, whether we're talking about Whitewalkers or carp, despite what Donald Trump would have you believe. And third, and maybe most importantly, we will only overcome this challenge, much like Whitewalkers, if we band together on this. So again, reflecting back on the way they control Whitewalkers, the most effective way to control Whitewalkers is dragon glass. It's a volcanic glass that they can fashion into weapons that can kill Whitewalkers. It's one of the few ways you can. By comparison, we're looking at a species-specific, at a virus, the carp virus to control carp. Now, a couple of advantages, if you like, of the virus over dragon glass. First of all, a volcanic weapon, a sharp glass weapon, could kill Whitewalkers. It can also kill almost anything you throw it at, whereas by comparison, this virus is species-specific. I'm going to go into some of the research to demonstrate that now. First of all, CSIRO did this work where they basically... This is a map, if you like, of all of the taxonomic groupings of bony fish that occur in the world, right? This green one down here is the group that carp belong to, cypriniforms, right? Now, these branches far over on the left-hand side are very, very distant relationships. The one on the right-hand side are more close relationships. So you can see cypriniforms that carp belong to. There are three other groups that are somewhat closely related to carp in the world, right? Two of them don't occur in Australia, and this red one, siluriforms, catfish, they do occur in Australia, right? So the most closely related taxonomic group to carp in Australia is catfish. Now, we know that if this virus would jump to another species, it would jump to a closely related species or species group. So you might just focus intensely on catfish, and if you show that they're insusceptible, by extension, you could say that more distantly related species would also be insusceptible. That's not the approach that CSIRO took. They tested a whole range of fish species of broad taxonomic relatedness to carp. They tested small species like olive perchlets. They tested big species like golden perch and silver perch. Tested rainbow fish and sea mullet, trout, even though they're not native, they're economically important, so they tested them. A whole range of species, and found that there was no evidence of this virus causing disease. It didn't even replicate in any other species other than carp. They also tested, example, mammals, reptiles, birds, amphibians, crustacea. You could see they're looking for species that might interact with this virus. There was no evidence of replication or disease in these species either. They didn't expect it to, because it's a fish virus and a herpes virus. They tend to have evolved to have a single species host over millennia, but it's good to see the research show that. So that's one of the advantages of biocontrol using a virus over dragonglass. The other is dragonglass is not self-perpetuating in time and space. What I mean by that is a virus, of course, as it sort of, you know, moves, as it infects, it creates, you know, it replicates in time and space. It, you know, spreads through a population. Dragonglass, you'd have to kill every white walker one at a time, so far less effective. In actual fact, in terms of biocontrol of weeds returns a cost benefit of about 23 to 1. So every dollar you spend on biocontrol saves you 23. So that's one of the reasons why biocontrol is so enticing as a way to control carp in Australia. I do have to make clear, though, that no one has ever looked at the benefit cost of using dragonglass. That's probably for another time. Finally, let's move on to the disadvantages. When you kill a white walker using dragon glass, the white walker turns to ice and shatters. That's pretty nice because it means you don't have to clean up the mess. We don't have that luxury here. We've got about 500,000 tons of carp that we need to explore. And how do we do that? Well, first of all, we're going to deliver the most precise continental estimate of biomass of carp ever undertaken. So how much are we talking about in tons, and where is it distributed in the landscape? That's going to be really important in helping us to understand how big is this challenge and to develop our cleanup strategy and to cost it appropriately. There's research going on right now populating mesocosms, these things, with different biomass levels of dead carp to understand how do different levels of dead carp impact on water quality. That's really important because we really need to understand that threshold that we need to intervene at and, you know, get carp out. We are doing a global scan of all of the ways that have ever been attempted to manage large fish kills to look at what works, in what kind of habitat types, at what cost, and what sorts of efficiency. We're doing some really sophisticated computer modelling to help us to answer questions like how many locations would we need to do the release in, how many fish do we need to infect, how often do we need to release. These sorts of questions will be answered through that sophisticated computer modelling done by CSIRO. And I'm not going to go into some important international case studies in the interest of time, but it's important to make the point, we don't just need to look at fish solutions to answer this fish problem. There are some fantastic and successful pest control examples that are terrestrial, and there are some really great lessons that we can learn from all of them, and we're in the process of pulling all that information together now. And last, it's all about resourcing. Yeah, this would be expensive if we did this, but the cost of doing nothing is expensive. One estimate of the cost of having carp swimming around in our waterways is about $500 million a year. So it's not really a question of do we spend our money or save it. It's really do we spend our money in a smart way or spend it in a way that we're not talking about, which is just not recognising and addressing a problem. Last, I'm going to fly over this because it's been covered so eloquently already, but we cannot just think that this is a carp problem. This isn't even a program. It is not a program about carp at all. It's a program about recovering the quality of our waterways and native fish. But we need to do other things to promote recovery of our waterways. And yeah, we should consider carp control, but we also need to look at screens on pumps. I'm really looking forward to Tom's presentation next up tomorrow afternoon. We've, you know, putting habitat back in rivers, improving the quality of water, not just the temperature, but the quality, so that we're creating conditions so our native fish can thrive as carp numbers dwindle. And of course, there are some species that won't come back no matter how healthy our waterways are because they haven't been seen in 40 or 50 years. We are going to have to restock them once we take the carp out. And restoring fish migration. We know we've got, and that was a disturbing but really impressive slide showing how many barriers we've got, and we need to put fishways on as many of them as we can so fish can move around. So what can you do? First of all, you can ask questions. We need to make sure that we are looking at this from all the right angles. And so we'd love to hear from you. I'm not here to build an army of people that want to put the virus in the water. I'm here to build an army of people that understand there's a robust scientific evidence-based process underway to support the process and to contribute to that. If you would like to see an end of carp, you can help us share information about this program that you've learnt today and through resources that I'll point towards in the moment. You can share your views. We're going to do some really extensive stakeholder consultation over the next 18 months. We want to hear from you. And maybe most importantly, you can help communicate the need to recover native fish through measures that I just mentioned earlier. So just to summarise, fortunately we do have a method available for use to control carp in Australia that appears to be effective and species specific, but we must understand how to use this. That means we need to understand and manage the risks. And fortunately, that's exactly what the National Carp Control Plan has been established to do. We've got some great resources, our website, carp.gov.au, we're on Vimeo, there's some great Q&As on YouTube, there's a hotline, email addresses, we just really want to hear from you, and we want you to go out there and learn what you can and share what you think. I might leave it there. Thank you.